Well, good morning. It's great to see you today. Let's stand together if you're able to. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your church. I thank you, Lord, for this time that we have together, quality time together with you, Lord. God, this is all for you. This is all for you. We come simply with one job, to surrender, to bow before you corporately, Lord. Jesus be magnified in me, in us, in this city. Have your way, Lord. Amen. Tis the grandest theme through the ages run. Tis the grandest theme for mortal time. Tis the grandest theme that the world ever sung.
Yes, I am. Fire, You have no equal. Be exalted, read some of our 5:11, which is based on 1 Thessalonians 5:11. It says, so encourage each other and build each other up, just as you are already doing. So these came in this week through either email or online. We are very much looking forward to the day that we can just pass them on and they'll be safe. So we had one reply, and it was like this: Pastor Chad, Daryl, and I would just like to thank you and Laura for all you do for our flock. You look after us well. You are a great shepherd. Lord bless Sharon and Daryl. Another note says, good morning, Pastor Chad. I have a testimony to share with you that will put a smile on your face. Once COVID hit, I increased my tithes and giving to the church roof fund. Well, I received a birthday card from my daughter this morning. She usually gives me $100, which is more than sufficient. But inside was a check for $500. And she isn't walking with the Lord. She had been working for a while, but she started again in the fall. I know this is my Heavenly Father blessing me through her. I am not in need at all. My heart's desire is for young believers to get this. You can never outgive the Lord. He is no man's debtor. Amen. Cindy McGuire wrote in and said, I'd like to praise the Lord for all the people and churches that are coming together to help us reach our goal for the roof. It only goes to show that when we trust God and give Him our needs, then just step back and watch how He works things out. He can do so much more when we don't put limits on Him. Thank you, Lord. Shelley Watson shared, hi, Pastor Jeff. Just writing to say hi and to hope you're having a good day. I have seen that the Lord is working His miracles for our roof, so I thought you could use a little laugh. There is a quote that says, if God can make above's bottom light up to decorate the night sky, imagine all He can do in your life. I like to use that for 5:11 on Sunday. I see this happening with the roof and other stuff that's happening in the church, and I appreciate it even more. And Pastor Chad has his prayer request that he's going to read, but before he does that, I would just like to thank all of the people who have been donating to the pantry ministry and coming to help each month. It is such a blessing. They gave out 62, 63 bags this past month. And just watching people talk and communicate and build relationships. Pastor Travis put a prayer table over there. And he got taken away, I think this was this month, right? And Wayne, you stepped in and you prayed for people, and you'll never know how much that blessed every single worker. So I thank you. Thank you all for your faithfulness.
Church, God is working for His glory, for His honor, for His pleasure. All of this is not about you. It's not about me. It's about the Lord Jesus. You know, sometimes we kind of misspeak a little bit. I know where it comes from, because I do it as well. But we say, well, that's my church. And it's good for us to feel a part of the body of Christ, for sure. We want commitment. But you know what? This isn't your church. This isn't my church. This is Christ's church. And He will do as He sees fit. We just have one job: to surrender to Him, to submit to Him, to follow Him. And so thank you for doing that. And I encourage you to continue to do that more. There's been a couple of prayer requests that have come in that are urgent. We want to pray for Jessica Howell, the mom that has this little baby right here. She's having some health problems. We want to pray for Jessica today. We also want to pray for baby Winter Sky, who's moving around a lot more and doing well, but still has some difficulty with one of her legs, with the movement. So we want to pray for that together. I also want to remember Bobby Baldenice in prayer. They are finalizing the last stages of the move to move out west to be closer to family. And we just appreciate Bob and Walda so much. They're heart for the Lord. Bob was telling me last week he was here at the original meeting that started this church congregation over 55 years ago. And so we're going to miss Bob and Walda, but we love you, and we're going to pray for you today and continue to pray for you. We also need to pray for Beth Corey this morning. Beth was on her way out the door for church and just fell suddenly ill. And is ill at home right now, so we want to really pray for her, that God would strengthen her. We could be here all afternoon talking about the physical problems that Beth has. She has a long list, but I want to pray for Beth Corey today, that God would touch her and raise her up. We want to pray for Christine Nave's friend that she mentioned to me, a neighbor that's having just a really difficult time in their health and in their loved one's health. We want to remember Lorraine Day in prayer today. She suddenly lost her sister this week after a very, very short 12-day battle with cancer publicly. And it was just really quick. Her sister Matt, but you know, Lorraine, thanks to the Lord, she was able to get there and be with her. She doesn't live right here. She was able to pray with her. She was able to share the Lord with her. So we rejoice in those things, but we need to pray. And today, if you have a request on your heart or something weighing on your life, would you just like to raise a hand? I want to just pray for all those things. If you have a need, just raise your hand. The Lord sees, the Lord knows. So God, come now, mighty God, by the rushing wind. Minister to these areas, oh God. Jesus, we mean what we said. You are powerful. There is no other name but the name of Jesus that brings life, that brings salvation, that brings healing, that brings hope, that brings peace, that brings reconciliation to God, that eradicates sin, Lord. So we come to you with these needs. You see, you know, Lord, better than we do. Minister of God. Even in this instant, healing, Lord, restoration. May healthy cells realign in these bodies, Lord. May a miracle touch from the Holy Spirit come right now in lives and hearts and homes, in relationships, in finances, in mental health, in employment. We pray, Lord, for physical healing today for Jessica, for Winter Sky, for Christine's friend in the hospital, for Beth Corey, Lord. Healing, Lord, in the name of Jesus. That this spirit of infirmity would be gone in the name of Jesus. Help and strength and vitality so these people can know you, can serve you, can live for you, can work for you, Lord, as witnesses. Your power at work today. For the niceness, Lord, may this move go smoothly. Bless them, encourage them, strengthen them, provide for them. We commit to continue to pray for them. We pray for those who are grieving today. We pray for Lorraine Day and her family, Lord, who lost very suddenly her sister. Help them, Lord. Heal them, Lord. Mend, Lord, their hearts as they walk through this journey of grief, this journey of sorrow, Lord. Minister, oh God, as only you can. Have your way, Lord. Have your way, God. Have your way, Lord. Jesus, be glorified. Jesus, be glorified. Turn our attention as we continue to worship the Lord to some announcements today. I want to remind you that our website is the best place, the hub, for you to get all the information about our church family, so please visit www.calvertemplesj.com. You can find our weekly bulletin that we're not able to print and distribute in hand, but we're able to put online there, and our calendar and all the other information about our church. We do welcome you to Calvary Temple Church. Today, we're so glad to be able to gather together and worship the Lord and encourage each other in the Lord. If you're here for the very first time today, we encourage you to take your phone out right now and text the word visitor to 506-634-1688. That is the church's phone number, and you'll get an instant reply from us. I forgot to listen to the kids, my bad, I'll do that now. We do have the baby art nursery upstairs. It's a self-use nursery for parents to use with their children aged 0 to 2. And then from age 3 to grade 5, we have Deeper Kids Ministry downstairs out this door. And so parents and guardians, you can take your children now to be registered downstairs for that ministry. Please don't forget to stop along the way and use the washroom. And don't forget to get your children at the end of the service as well. God bless you, ministry workers and children, as front. We're so glad that you're all here. We just rejoice in you being here in the name of Jesus. As I was saying, don't forget to text the word visitor to our church phone number. You'll get an instant reply from us if you're here for the first time. Want to remind you, kind of late now, but I'll just remind you that we do have a drive-by wedding shower that's happening here at 12 o'clock out in front of the church. Sherry Savoy, who grew up here, is being married to Patrick Rayner in just a couple of weeks. I'm officiating that wedding, and so their family and friends asked if they could have a drive-by shower, so they're doing that at noon hour out in front of the church for those who wish to express best wishes or give gifts or cards or whatever to the happy couple. So just be aware of that, and feel free to walk by the bride out there and say hi and bless her and encourage her as well. Does anyone know what's happening here tonight at 6 o'clock? There's a couple of you. Yeah, you've got different names for it, which is kind of fun. But we call it Kids Explosion. We gather children and bring them here and explode them. So if you have any kids that you'd like to get rid of, please bring them tonight. We will implode them for you right here. No, it's an event for all ages. And we're really excited. I'm just going to say two things here before I do my official announcement. I am so excited. First off, this is the first one we've been able to do in a year and a half because of COVID. Secondly, this evening's Sunday night event, unlike the last year and a half, is an in-person event only. I like that. We're actually gathering together in person again. And so we're really excited about that. We're doing all the measures, we're doing all the distancing, we have to wear masks, we're being very, very careful to follow all protocols. But we are meeting in person tonight at 6 o'clock. It's for all ages. We're going to be looking at a Bible story together. We're going to be having games and live worship music, creative Bible lesson puppets, member verse activity, and then takeout hot dogs and beverages. Kids Explosion always have hot dogs and beverages, but because of COVID, we're doing that strictly on the way out the door as a takeout meal. So please join in tonight if you can. Bring somebody with you. We're looking for a really great time. It's for people of all ages. Somebody from this church talked to me this week and told me that they had invited four people to come tonight, and they think they're all coming. And so that really excited me, some of their grandkids and whatnot. We're just so glad anybody and everyone is welcome this evening. What is our pantry food ministry drive item for the month of July? Do you know what it sounded like you said from up here? So you can bring margarine partner if you'd like, or we'd really like to have 100 cans of meat if you're able to. We would like to have those by next Sunday if we can. So please bring those in to the pantry table right over here if you're able to. That would help us so much as we serve our guests that come later this month. Please don't forget, tomorrow at 1 o'clock we have our in-person prayer gathering, and we'd love for you to join in and seek the Lord together. Also, quick note, teens, young adults, and young families, there is no Deepwater Next Gen Ministry this week. Only please be aware of that so that you don't come known this year. I want to say thank you for your faithful worship to the Lord with your finances. As we partner together and give our tithes and offerings to the Lord, we're able to change this world with the love, the truth, the grace, and the power of Jesus Christ. If you choose to give today, there's a variety of ways that you can give. It's on our website, we have a gift page. There's a whole bunch of ways you can give electronically, or if you wish, you can make a donation on your way out at the offering box that is there. As we partner together, we're able to change this world for Jesus. Amen? Amen. Amen. Well, I'm going to ask Pastor O'Coin to come, and he's going to be sharing the Word of God today. We are so pleased to have Pastor O'Coin and Linda in our church and still involved in ministry. I consider Pastor O'Coin a great friend, and I consider him a confidant and a huge encouragement, especially as we traverse through this COVID time and the many challenges that we experience today. He has been an encouragement to this pastor and a great support. And I want to just plug this in, if it's okay with you. We are really thrilled as well that we received notification this week that Pastor O'Coin's home church, Desert Oxo Pentecostal Church, has chosen through their leadership to make a donation of $5,000 to our roof project. So let's thank the Lord, praise the Lord. He's the one who's opening these doors and helping us in this endeavor. God bless you, Pastor, as you come and share the word.
Thank you very much. That was an interesting journey with my home congregation. As you remember, the church on the Queensway with Billy Richards had thrown out the challenge, and they had already given $5,000, and they said they'd give another $5,000 if a church would match it. We'd already had churches that had done that and more, but we didn't want to go there because we wanted to encourage other churches. So I contacted my home church, and the pastor said that he would bring it to the board, but there was a problem. I said, "What's that?" And he said, "I think there's some conflict of interest because your sister and brother-in-law are on the board." But I got word that they didn't pass it, and they did not take they didn't take part in that. There really was no conflict of interest. There was no money to be given to the church, so we're thrilled with that. And it's just great to be with you this morning. We will some of the restrictions are being removed, and we can now visit with some of our family in Ontario. So Lord willing, we'll be spending Canada today with Jonathan and his family, and then going down to our college to Lake Shore camp. So this is our last Sunday here for a few weeks, but we'll be back again. But it's just a delight to address you this morning, and it's good to see some friends here. Doug and Marie Moore, just a delight to see you come into the sanctuary this morning. It's just a delight to see you. I shouldn't even dare to try to guess if there's other visitors here, but good to see Nancy here. I know where Nancy was, but I'm not sure what that last name is now. But anyway, Nancy, it's just good to have you home. Delighted to have you with your mom here this morning. Amen. So it's just a delight to have you all here. I want to share the word of the Lord this morning. I'm going to read a number of scriptures from John chapter 14, 15, 16, where we're talking about the Comforter, the Holy Spirit. The Comforter has come, is the title of my message. And we're beginning to read from John 14, 15 through 18, and then we're just going to jump in other scriptures through chapters 14, 15, and 16. Jesus said, "If you love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another Comforter, that he may abide with you forever and ever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you." Verses 25 to 29. "These things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatever I have said to you. Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Ye have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again to you. If you love me, you would rejoice, because I said, I go to my Father, and my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it came to pass, that when it comes to pass, ye might believe." Going to chapter 15, 26 to 27. "But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send to you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. And ye also shall bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning." And then go to chapter 16, 7 to 15. "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will reprove the world of sin and righteousness and judgment of sin, because they believe not in me, of righteousness, because I go to my Father, and ye see me no more, of judgment, because the prince of the world is judged. I have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatever he shall hear, that shall he speak. and I will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. All these things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore I said, that he shall take of mine and show it to you. Amen. And the blessing of the Lord is upon his word. Let us just have a moment of prayer. Father, I just pray that as we consider your word this morning, that you would speak to us. Father, I pray that indeed as we talk about the comfort, that we can provide some comfort, some word of encouragement, that before this service is concluded, people will be freshly encouraged from what you are doing and what your word says, and by the moving of the Spirit in each one of our hearts and lives. So speak to us, I pray, in Christ's name. Amen. In the passage that I just concluded reading, the word comforter is used over and over again. As a matter of fact, I believe it was used 5 times. The setting of this discourse is significant. It is just prior to the crucifixion, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. And all these events would conclude with his departure, with his ascension. So he is preparing the church. He's preparing his disciples for these events. And he encourages them that when these events take place and when Jesus eventually does depart, that he is going to send another comforter. In a natural way, and indeed it was a fact that when he left and ascended, the disciples, you know, it wasn't a good day for them. But he says, you don't need to worry. Something is going to happen after I leave this world, and I need to encourage you with this. He says, don't be discouraged. I'm going, but I'm coming back. Now, interestingly, we usually think that when he says that, I'm coming back, yes, he's coming back in his second coming. But really, in the context here, Jesus is saying, I'm coming back real soon in the person of the third person of the Trinity, in the person of the Holy Spirit. So, you know, we're looking for Jesus to come back, and that's right, and that's appropriate, and we need to prepare to look for that. But I want you to know, by the Holy Spirit, Jesus has already come back. He's already here. Isn't that wonderful to think that Jesus is already here in the person of the Holy Spirit? And we're going to emphasize and talk about various aspects of that this morning. There are a few words and phrases of the portion of Scripture that I read that I would like to highlight because I think they're of tremendous importance. The first, of course, is that word, comfort. Jesus says, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. That word, Comforter, originally it was used as one called alongside to aid another, as an advocate in a court of justice. Then later, used to denote the act of consoling or consolation, and gave rise to this term, comforter. Speaking of the comforter in his book, The Holy Spirit, Dr. Ross says, the comforter is a poor translation of the Greek word parakletos, to someone to the side, hence one who is called to one side to aid, to advocate, to counsel. The child of God is never alone, for he has sent the Comforter, the Advocate, to ever be at our side as an aid, as a helper, and as a sufficient one. I like the way the Amplified works. When he, the Amplified author of the translation refers to this verse, verse 14, 16. He says, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another comforter.
And then in brackets, he puts all the various shades of meaning to that word comforter. And I want to encourage you with these various shades of meaning of the word comforter. It means counselor. Aren't you thankful you've got the Holy Spirit? That when you need help, he's there to be your counselor. You know, it's good to get good counsel and good advice. If you have a problem, you have a situation, you're going through a difficulty, before I married Linda, I went to a lawyer. But this wasn't for marriage counseling, this was to deal with practical things. And I needed some help. And so I talked to the lawyer about how we would divide things and how things would work. And somehow he mentioned something about living on Treadwell Drive. I said, Treadwell Drive? Well, you might know the lady that I'm going to marry. And he says, who is that? And I said, Linda Pittman. And immediately he says, we got a problem. The problem is, the lawyer was Linda's former husband's high school friend from way back, and he was Linda's lawyer, which I didn't know. And the lawyer that Linda had cannot be the lawyer I had, because that same man was looking after the interest of Linda, and I needed someone to look after the interest of Gordon. So we have a problem. No, I don't need to bear that. But it's good to have someone to get good counsel from, get good advice from, and it's good to have someone here that can do that. But I want you to know that we have a counselor in the Holy Spirit, that he can give you better advice than any man, any lawyer, any defense attorney can give you. Jesus, the Holy Spirit, can give it to you. He is your comforter. He is your counselor. He is your counselor. That word comforter means counselor. It means helper. Hallelujah. Aren't you thankful for helpers that come alongside when you need a lifting hand, when you need someone to help you? I'm so happy. The Holy Spirit, the comforter, is our helper. He is our interceder. He intercedes for us. Hallelujah. When we make mistakes, when we do something wrong, I'm so thankful the Holy Spirit intercedes for us to lift us up, to build us. He is our interceder. He is our advocate. Hallelujah. It's good to have an advocate. It's good to have someone on your side when you're going through difficulties. In this world, you're going to have a lot of people that come against you. It's good to have someone on your side. It's good to have friends that are on your side. And I want you to know the comfort of the Holy Spirit is your friend, and he's on your side. I want you to know that the comforter is on your side. If all the world seems to be arrayed against you, and circumstances seem to be stacked against you, he is on your side. Hallelujah. So whatever you're going through this morning, I want you to know the comforter is on your side. He is your advocate. He is your intercessor. He is your advocate. He is your strengthener. Hallelujah. I might not get me on this verse this morning. It's just so much in it. Hallelujah. He is your strengthener. Do you ever get weak? Some time ago, I had to go into the hospital with some blood work, and it was during COVID. You know all the questions they asked me? You know, do you ever have a temperature? Do you have diarrhea? And you know, quite honestly, most of those symptoms at one time or another I had. Then he said, then every person, do you ever feel weak? And I said, I'm 77 years old. Yes, I feel weak once in a while. You know, I know they have to ask those questions. But, I feel bad when we feel weak. When we feel weak, the Holy Spirit is our strength. He builds us up. He lifts us up. He edifies us. The Comforter has come. Hallelujah.
by your side.
I have friends over the years. Most of them are true, and they're true blue. They would stand beside me. There's been a few. You know, I thought I needed them. They just seemed to, you know, float off into their shadows. But I come back home. I'm so back home, Holy Spirit. Stand beside us. The Comforter has come. The Holy Spirit from heaven. To be there alongside.
That little phrase, I want to add the word to Comforter. He says, another Comforter. I'm going to send unto you another Comforter. That word, another, is an interesting word in the context here. Another does not mean something different. The Comforter is not different from Christ. But another has a similar quality. The Comforter, the Holy Spirit, is a separate person, but he carries all the same attributes of Jesus. So when Jesus says another Comforter is come, that someone else just like me, Jesus is saying, that he's going to be everything to you that I have been to you when I walked upon this earth. Some of us have stopped and wanted to be wonderful. And we had a trip to the Holy Land, it was wonderful to walk where Jesus walked. And we could wish that, oh, we weren't alive when Jesus was alive. It would be so wonderful to walk with him. But Jesus says that when I send the Comforter, he is going to be as real to you as if I was still here physically. Hallelujah. The Comforter has come. Another Comforter just like Jesus, and yet it's a different person. Three persons in the Trinity, obviously. Then another phrase that I'd like to emphasize. When he says, I will not leave you comfortless. I will not leave you comfortless. The literal meaning of this is, I will not leave you bereaved. I will not leave you as orphans. Therefore, when I ascend, he said to his disciples, you should rejoice. That's the last thing in the natural that we would want to do, and some that we depended upon leaves us. But he says, I'm not going to leave you bereaved. I'm not going to leave you as orphans. That word comfortless is only used one other time in the New Testament. It's found in James 1:27. And when the original Greek word is translated there, it's not translated comfortless, it's translated fatherless. So he said, I will not leave you as orphans. I will not leave you fatherless. Hallelujah. So aren't you thankful? The Amplified Bible puts it this way. I will not leave you orphans, comfortless, desolate, bereaved, forlorn, helpless. Hallelujah. He's not going to leave you with any of those negative attributes, any of those negative things, but he's not going to leave us father. He's going to be a father to us. He's going to be everything to us that Jesus was to us, was to the world when he was here. Then there's another word that I want to emphasize. It says, it is expedient that I leave you. I don't know, but I just had a little sinking suspicion that maybe these disciples might have just questioned what Jesus is saying. It is expedient. The last thing they wanted was for Jesus to leave. And yet he says, it is expedient for me to leave you. Now, that word expedient, the dictionary definition is simply this: suitable for accomplishing a desired result. Suitable for accomplishing
a desired result. Now, in the Greek New Testament, the original meaning means from, together, or to bear, to bring. The underlying idea of the word is concurrence of circumstances. Therefore, in light of all these circumstances that is going to happen in the next few days, in light of all these circumstances, the best thing for you is that I leave. Sometimes, none of you would ever. But there's been times that I have questioned God. Anybody else ever question the way God leads? But I want you to know, if God is leading our life, everything that He does is expedient. It's for our good. In light of all the circumstances, but here's the difficulty is, God, from His vantage point, knows the big picture. He knows all the circumstances. Our definition of the circumstances is framed by only a few moments in time. But God's circumstances is framed with eternity in mind and what's best for us for eternity. We see the little picture, God sees the big picture. And in this particular case, he says, it's expedient. And the best thing that I can do for you under all the circumstances is that I will ascend to the Father. Because unless I ascend to the Father, the Comforter will not come. So that's why he says, it is expedient that I leave. Now, I just want to look and see some of the things from this portion of Scripture that the Holy Spirit will do for you. I've already listed a number of things in defining these words, but let us consider in this portion of Scripture. Now, I'm not going to be able to do the best I can. Well, I got lots of time. Stacy told me that she put a new battery in the microphone that I had on, and it lasts for about over an hour. So I said to Stacy, that's great, I got about over an hour. She says, you only have it on YouTube. But anyway, I got 9 or 10 things that the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, will do for you that I find in this portion of Scripture. I might not get through it all, that's fine. But the Comforter, number one, 14:16, it says, and I will pray the Father, and He will give you another Comforter, and He shall abide with you forever. Hallelujah. This is not a temporary thing. The Comforter will abide with us forever. Lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. 1 John 2:26 talks about that anointing. He says that anointing that He has given you, that Comforter that He has given you, that you have received from Him, will be with you always. And that Comforter, that anointing is real, is not a counterfeit, and will be with you always. I am so thankful. There's nothing about the Holy Spirit. There's nothing about the Comforter that is fickle. He will be with you through thick and thin, and every circumstance of life. I'm sure I've shared this as a young person. They used to have testimony services way back when, you know, when the dinosaurs were still on the earth and I was young. And I know you can't believe this, but when I was given my testimony, I'm talking late teens, early 20s, in my home church, and I'm giving a testimony. I know you can't believe that, but sometimes I got excited. And sometimes words would come out of my mouth without thinking
of what I was saying. And I remember saying it. And I said, in my excitement, I said the truth. He's with us always. You see, we have this, in Pentecostal circles, we have this erroneous idea that something we come out of a red hot Pentecostal meeting, and there's a great after service, or there's a crescendo of worship and praise, and we say, wasn't that wonderful? God was with us tonight. But I want you to know God is just as much with you over the kitchen sink on Monday morning. God is just as much with you in the difficulties of life. God is with you on the job. God is with you on the golf course. God is with you in your car. He says, I will never leave you. He says, I'm going to send a comfort. See, Jesus is thinking about that. You know, you can only be with me where I am physically while I'm still here. When I send a comforter, he's going to be with you always. I can't do that right now, but when the comforter is succeeding, it's good that I go away so I can be with you always. And if you think that's not good enough, the next thing he says, not only will I be with you, look at point number two, but what he will do, he shall not be with us only, he shall be with us. Look at verse 17. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But you know him, for he dwells with you. Hallelujah. Hold on. Hold on. That's not the end of the story. He's saying to the disciples, this is not something that the world can understand. This is not something that the world can receive. This is something very special for those who believe upon me. I am with you, but the day is coming when I send the comforter. I'm not going to just be with you. I'm with you. Hallelujah. If you weren't so conservative, you should be standing on your seat and shouting hallelujah. You talk about a miracle. I want you to know, if the Comforter has come to you, if you're born again this morning, he's not just with you, he lives in you. He lives in you. Out of your most inner being, the Spirit flows. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Comforter has come. The Holy Ghost. He's with us. And he is in us. I just thank the Holy Spirit. Thirdly, the Comforter will teach you all things. Hallelujah. The Comforter will teach you all things. Verse 26. Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. He shall teach you all things. He is called. He is the Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will lead you into all truth. As you abide in Jesus and he abides in you, as the Holy Spirit lives within you, he will teach you what you need to know. And he will lead and guide you. Not only that, in the same verse he goes a little bit further, he shall teach you and he shall bring all things to your remembrance. Now this is going to be important for the disciples. Because for 3.5 years, Jesus has been teaching them. And for 3.5 years of all his life, they just don't get it. And they don't get it until the Comforter comes.
And, you know, I understand that with the disciples, the apostles.
But I know I have. I will read scripture and we need to constantly study and research.
And at the moment, I read it and don't always understand it. But sometimes in the future, when I need it, the Holy Spirit brings that word to my remembrance. Sometimes you think, oh, I'm just reading the Bible and it doesn't make sense. I told you the wonderful miracle of my brother who had not served the Lord. I got one brother that served the Lord always, but Donnie didn't. Donnie was at death's door and to the place where they told him, if we operate, we die at the operating table, but if we don't operate, we definitely will die. And he phoned me for prayer. And I prayed with him. Then I hung up. I said, I never asked him to start with God. And I prayed, Lord, don't let him die until I get to see you. And we were heading, this is a couple of winters ago, and we were heading to Ontario. On the way back, we came from Ontario. And I went into the hospital room. And Linda took his wife, my sister-in-law, Marilyn, to another room. It was just two brothers talking. I started talking to Don about the Lord. And it was just one of those Holy Ghost moments. And he got gloriously saved, and he still got health problems. He says, I can go in time. He has very little bit of strength and so forth, but he's living one day at a time. He says, I know where I'm going, and I'm ready to go, but I don't want to leave my wife there. His big concern. I'm ready to go with my house, I can go any minute, but I don't want to leave my wife. But that's not the point. Donnie is not a reader. But someone gave him the whole Bible. I'm not sure whether it was on a disc or a manuscript or whatever. But anyway, he has gone through the Bible, listened to it two or three times already. And he listened to it 3 hours a day. He says, Gordon, I don't understand. And I said, all that stuff. Yes, I don't get all that stuff. But you know something? The Holy Spirit brings that to our remembrance. Things that we need. And it's just to be aware. He didn't understand any of that stuff until the comforter came. But when the comforter came, and he reads the Bible, God teaches him. And then when he needs it, God brings those things back to his memory. So he brings things back. The Holy Spirit, the comforter, brings things back to our memory. And then the comforter gives us Verse 14:27, peace I leave you, my peace I give you, not as the world did to get right onto you. I've been expounding on this for a long time. But I'm just thank the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. You know something? Why do we spend so much time in anxiety and worry about all things when they come? I'm tempted to say that's almost a slap in the face to the Holy Spirit. Because he says, I'm giving you peace. I'm here at all times. I'm your comforter. I'm your advocate. I'm your lawyer. I'm your stand beside. So we have, if we've got the Holy Ghost, if we've got the comforter, he will give you peace. If you rely upon Jesus, if you rely upon I want you to know he'll bring you through to the other side. This too will come to pass. We sure have had our disappointments during what's going on. I've had my hopes dashed so many times during these last 18 months, I've lost all hope about the experts are saying. We heard Nova Scotia was going to open up, and this afternoon we were planning to go to Nova Scotia. My grandmother just graduated, and I want to get there. Because the fear changed his mind. And this has happened so many times that I can't find peace with what the politicians say. I can't find peace with what the experts say, but I can find peace when I rely on the Holy Ghost. Amen? My peace I give you. And he says in 15:26-27, the Comforter will testify of me. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. The work of the Holy Spirit is to take the things of Jesus and bear witness of them unto us.
They will testify of me. But when the Comforters come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth that proceedeth from the Father, shall testify of me. Now I could go into the whole next phrase, and then it says, and you shall bear witness of me. That's for another time. But the work of the Holy Spirit testifies of Jesus. The work of the Holy Spirit reproves the world of sin and righteousness and judgment to come. That's another whole hour message. The Holy Spirit not only teaches us all things, the Holy Spirit guides us into all truth. 16:13. The Holy Spirit will show you things to come. And I got the way on through. And I want to stop here with my last one this morning. The Comforter will glorify Jesus. Verses 14 and 15 of chapter 16. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore said I, that he shall take of mine and show it unto you. Among other things, the primary work of the Holy Spirit is to testify of and give glory to the Son, Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit, I don't know if this is appropriate to say, but the Holy Spirit is the shining mirror of the Trinity. He doesn't like to give glory to anyone. He doesn't like to give glory to himself. He wants to, the Holy Spirit gives glory to the Son, gives glory to the Father. He gives glory. He takes the things of Jesus and makes them relevant and meaning unto us. The Comforter has come, the Holy Spirit from heaven. Aren't you thankful that the Comforter has come? Aren't you thankful he has left us as orphans? Or fatherless, that he doesn't just live with us always, but he also lives in us. Think about it for a moment. And as the pastor and the worship team comes to lead us, let's stand this morning. Would you stand to be capable of doing it? Let's just worship. Let's just worship Jesus. Let us worship the Holy Spirit. The Comforter has come. Hallelujah. I don't know what you're going through this morning. You could be going through a lot of trials and difficulties, and you need a helper, you need an advocate, you need a consoler, you need a father. The Comforter is all those things. The Comforter has come. Oh, hallelujah. 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 The Comforter has come. Hallelujah. We don't look to another. You're already here. Hallelujah. Well, we look for your second coming. We thank you. You're already here in the person of the Holy Ghost. Father, let me just worship you. Might we rely upon the Holy Spirit this morning? Once again, we just give you thanks. Hallelujah.
All things that surround you.
say, I really need prayer, we invite you to come to the front, to the altar, to the place of prayer and commitment. Pastor Arlen, we'd love to pray with you. Ask you to stand 6 feet apart from anyone that's not in your friend or family group. We just want to pray for you and support you in the Lord. If you need prayer, why don't you come? We'll pray together. When I look to your holy hands, when I gaze into your loving hands, when all pains have surround, become shadows in the lines of you. When I found the joy of reaching your
look for in His wonderful
And may you go in the peace and the grace and the truth and the power of God. God bless you.